over the last, maybe the last 5-6 years, is that I've actually looked at a lot of different team models, as well as my experience working with team and consulting. And there are 6 things that organization wants to do in order to make sure the team has high performance. If you look at the model that we have created, the center of it is results, which is the goal. So whenever a team comes together, the question, do we know the goal or only the leader knows the goal? That is the first thing we need to clear. And everything else that that makes a team high performing is in the pursuit of the goal or in the pursuit of the result. So where we are coming from is, if every team members are made to focus on the team results, they will become high performing over time, right? Now, what do we mean by result? The commitment to the team result. It's not about commitment to my own KPI or my own task. It's, do your team members know what this team wants to achieve? Do your team members know if we achieve this, what is the benefit of it? If we achieve this, how it's going to make the company better? So team members have to know that. The challenge is, a lot of the time, team leaders assume team members have this. How do I know that? Whenever I run a team development program and we ask the team leader tell me, Isaac, my team member knows. Then when we run a facilitation session during our program and we ask, we say, so what is the goal of this team? What are the things that the team needs to do? Everybody just look to the team leader. And, you know, it's funny, because then the team leader say, guys, I told you already. And then we realize the communication tends to be one way. So that's one. The second one, sensing. And you don't find this in other leadership model. Sorry, in other team model. Now, sensing is the ability to notice changes that will affect the team and its result. Now, this, in the older model, we tend to assume that leader does this. In a self-managing team or in a high-performing team, every member does this. So, for example, let's say one of your team member, let's say your production, and one of your team member has a friend in quality. And, you know, when they are talking, the quality guy told him that, hey, actually, we heard CEO plans to do this. And then you realize, hey, if they do that, it kind of conflict with your team goal. Then you'll bring back to the team and talk to the team there and say, I'm hearing this from the other person. What do you think? Is this going to affect? Now, sensing also means the team leader will now check with the senior leadership and say, we understand that this is happening. Is this true? If this is true and it conflicts with our team goal, do we need to revise our team goal? So in a high-performing team, changing the goal is accepted and normal. What's important is for the team to recognize why the change is required. So sensing is a critical part, because it's the one that allows the team to navigate and be fluid in the way they move, right? In the old team model, we don't do sensing, because the assumption is, if the boss asks us to do, we should just do and just keep quiet, because they have their ideas. In a high-performing team, we always want to check back. We don't assume that the management has considered everything, because as you realize, as change happens, there are so many things the management have to consider. Sometimes they actually forget what they told you, which means it could be a situation they started your project, you run it, but along 3 months later, they are doing something else and they actually forgot your project is running. So when they do it, it actually conflicts with yours. But if you don't tell them, then what happens is 2 projects will be fighting for same resources, right? And guess what? The newer project might get a resource because it's fresh on the mind of the CEO. So sensing is important. Third, responsibility. Take ownership of their task. Now, you notice one thing that happens in normal team is, when a person does something and they hit roadblock, sometimes they tend to just keep quiet. In a high-performing team, a person takes, when they hit a roadblock, they will try to figure a way around it. That's one. Secondly, when you ask them, why do you do it this way? They are able to explain it to you exactly why they have done it this way and why not the other way. And this is very important, because sometimes when you ask team member, why do you do it? They just say, don't know. Or they will just say, you told me to do. Right? But in a high-performing team, that doesn't happen. What happens is, the team member will check with you. You asked me to do it this way, but I think doing the other way is better. So the two-way communication becomes very, very strong. Now, the fourth one, conflict. And I indicate it as courage to voice and deal with differing opinions and views. The Asian community or the Asian culture has never been comfortable with conflict. We have viewed conflict as something that's negative towards relationship. So you notice sometimes we people bring up something and then there's a bit of fighting, we say, okay, never mind, never mind, never mind. Let's take it easy. We don't address the situation, we pacify it. Now, the problem with that is it creates unhappy team members. So in a high-performing team, conflict is actually welcome because why? Every one of us have a point of view. And we never know that one point of view that could actually change the whole team, if the person don't speak up, it's going to affect the whole team. So conflict needs to be encouraged. When we say conflict needs to be encouraged, it's not purposely having conflict, but the conflict is because team members want the team to be better. So that's the premise of it. Now, alignment. Now, this alignment is interesting. Alignment means if say there's five team members and everyone doing different parts, we actually know who's doing what, that's one. Secondly, we actually know if the person didn't do his part, what's the effect into my job? Or if I don't complete my part, how is it going to affect others? Now, what's the outcome of that? If the team is aligned, let's say I'm going to delay, I can't complete today, I'll complete tomorrow. I will know if I complete tomorrow, so one day delay, I know the next guy will have to delay 1 week because of this 1 day delay. In a normal team, I just do my part. So if I delay 1 day, I just do delay 1 day. I'll just maybe talk to the team leader. But in a high-performing team, if I know what I'm going to do delays you, I will actually come to you and say, hey, I got this problem. How and it's going to delay. Is there any way we can manage it together? Or I have no other choice. Or who else can help me? Then what happens, this problem actually say, okay, why don't you call the other person? Let's have a small team meeting to see how we help you. That is what we mean by team alignment. And this is where really makes a high-performing team wow. Because the team members are working among themselves. They don't need a team leader to step in all the time. In a team that is normal, right, you realize we always go to the team leader and the team leader has to figure out everything. In a high-performing team, even with the team leader away, the members are able to resolve their issues. And that's what makes it amazing, right? And the final part, trust. Now, trust here is interesting. It's not about I trust you or you don't trust me. One of the biggest challenges in a culture where relationship is high, whenever somebody says, hey, you don't trust me, we keep quiet because, you know, it's sensitive. Over here, trust focuses on willingness to be vulnerable, which means if I don't know how to do it, I will tell you, okay, I'm sorry, I don't know how to do it. Now, it sounds easy, right? But a lot of time we are afraid to do that because of people's opinion of us. Why? Because we do not feel safe in such environment. So in a high-performing team, while we have conflict and we fight, and we know we fight because it is to improve the results, we also have this sense that, you know, we are looking out for each other, that if somebody don't know something, we will help the person. And therefore, we actually feel safe telling people that we don't know. Because if I can tell you that I don't know, I will get support, that's one. If I can tell you I don't know, at least it doesn't jam up the entire project. Because you notice sometimes when a person don't know something and they dare not tell people, what happens is they delay the work. And then when they delay to the point that it cannot be delayed, and when the leader confront them, they actually say, I don't know. And that's what happens in some teams that don't communicate. So these are the six factors that we have developed, and I found it to be one reason why I developed this team model, because I find it fits the Asian culture, the relationship culture, a lot better.
Right. Isaac, coming to that model, is there any specific reason why you put trust at the outer layer? Is it according to the sequence towards the result?
So if you think about, so the way I put trust at the outer is it holds everything together. For example, if alignment, right, if I don't have trust, I will share very little information. I won't share everything. I will tell you I'm delaying by 1 day, but I will not tell you it's delayed by 1 day because I messed up something, right? So trust is an emotion. So the way we design this is a trust is a feeling. So if you don't feel safe, that means there's no trust. If you feel safe, then there's trust. So you can have all the five components, but without trust, right, the team will not come together. That's why we put it as the outer layer to hold everything together. Okay. Hopefully that helps you. Okay. All right. So now, so for me, I came from a technical background. When we developed this model, one of the things was we developed a diagnostic tool. Because people will say, Isaac, how do I know I'm a high-performing team or how am I not a high-performing team, right? So we actually have a diagnostic model, almost like a 360 survey for the team to give us a sense what are the behaviors that team needs to improve in order to achieve these six capabilities.